Sulfates, fatty alcohols, silicones, preservatives. Why are they in shampoo and conditioner, and do you need to avoid them? Hi, I'm Michelle, chemistry PhD and cosmetic chemist. Today, we're doing a deep dive into some of the key ingredients in hair care products. This video is sponsored by The Ordinary, who turned a lot of people into skincare nerds with their focus on ingredients, and now they're moving into hair care. Let's start with shampoo. To me, the best way to approach analyzing formulas is to think, what is the point of this product? What is its function? Shampoo obviously cleans your hair and scalp. Just like skin, your scalp produces sebum, which we usually think of as oil. This oil keeps your skin and scalp nice and soft, and it also travels along the hair to keep that soft as well. But sometimes we have too much oil, some of us like me, more than others. It also tends to stick to things like dirt, dust, skin flakes, and pollution. You might also use styling products that need to be washed off. The problem is, if you just try to use water to degrossify everything a bit, it usually doesn't work very well because oil and water don't mix. So to make the mix, we use a shampoo, and the key ingredients in the shampoo that clean are surfactants. Surfactants are really useful ingredients because they have a head that likes water and a tail that likes oil. And so instead of repelling each other, the surfactants allow the oil to basically be smuggled into the water in lots of tiny droplets, and then you can wash that away down the drain. Yay. There are surfactants in tons of different products because getting oil and water to stay together is really useful. For cleaning, the best surfactants are anionic surfactants. These have a negatively charged head, and they're used in tons of cleaning products, shampoo obviously, but also laundry detergent, dishwashing detergent, body washes, and face cleansers. Some of the anionic surfactants that you might have seen in your shampoos and cleansers are sulfates, sulcosinates, taurates, and isothionates. Traditional soaps also have anionic surfactants called carboxylates. So that's what the sulfates are doing. But why are people talking about sulfate-free? Well, a lot of it is based on misinformation. Once you start digging into the science behind shampoos, you start to realize that limiting yourself to sulfate-free shampoos doesn't really make sense. Sulfate surfactants are a diverse group of ingredients that behave in different ways. And on top of that, they can be combined in formulas in lots of different ways to give very different shampoos. It's a bit like eggs in a recipe. Just seeing eggs in the ingredients list doesn't tell you whether they use the whites or the yolks or a mix, how the food tastes, or whether you'll like it. Unless you have an egg allergy, in which case you probably should avoid it unless you really like pain or you're vegan. So generalizing sulfates in products doesn't really work. It isn't like shampoos with sulfates are always harsher or more irritating or strip color faster than sulfate-free shampoos. There is a lot of overlap. Sulfates are some of the most commonly used anionic surfactants in personal care products. The two you'll see most in shampoos are sodium lauryl sulfate, SLS, and sodium laureth sulfate, SLES. These sound pretty similar, but they're actually very different. Sodium lauryl sulfate is the more famous one, and it has a bad reputation, which has now spread to other sulfates. It has a narrow structure, and that means it can potentially absorb into skin more easily and keep irritating for longer. If SLS is in a formula on its own in a high concentration, then it'll probably be quite irritating, and this is one of the big reasons why it has this irritant reputation. A lot of the time in peer-reviewed studies and in dermatology patch testing, SLS is used by itself to make sure it is the specific ingredient that someone is reacting to. But this also means it isn't in its usual environment, which is in a product with a lot of other ingredients that change how it interacts with skin and with hair. There are lots of formulating tricks that are usually used in SLS products. Here are some of them. Creating mixed micelles by combining SLS with other surfactants. This makes SLS less likely to wander off on its own into your skin or hair. It's like peer pressure, but for molecules. Adding polymers that act as a raft to hold onto free SLS molecules. Again, this is so it can't run away into your skin or hair. Adding skin protecting ingredients like humectants and antioxidants that can prevent or reverse some of the irritation. Now, SLES. Sodium laureth sulfate actually isn't one single ingredient. It's actually a category of ingredients that are all listed under the same name in an ingredients list. Ingredient lists don't really lie, but they don't really tell you the full story either. SLES is ethoxylated, which means it's SLS, but with a bunch of ethoxy units inserted next to the sulfur like this. The number of units can change, and this changes how the specific type of SLES interacts with everything else, water, oil, or other surfactant molecules. Having these ethoxy units means that less SLES will wander off on its own into your skin compared to SLS. Ethoxylation also makes the molecule bigger, which means it doesn't penetrate skin as easily and is more gentle. It's a bit like walking through a crowd. If you want to get through a crowd faster, you try to hunch and make yourself smaller. You don't spread your arms out. There's one study that found that SLES was gentler than SLS, which is not very surprising, but it was also gentler than a whole bunch of non-sulfate surfactants that you often find in sulfate-free products. And on top of this, formulators can use the same formulating tricks that I mentioned before to make SLES products even gentler. Now with color fading. I have a strong personal interest in this, as you can probably tell. When I first dyed my hair 4 years ago, I used sulfate-free shampoos because that's what everyone says is best for keeping your hair color for longer. Except, I hated all the sulfate-free shampoos that I tried. And I spent a lot of money on them because I went with a lot of very fancy brands. I ended up just going back to sulfate shampoos, and I didn't actually notice much of a difference with my hair color fading. Recently, I got to see some experimental data on color fading that confirmed what I noticed happening with my hair. With color fading, there are some differences between different shampoo formulas. As you'd expect from everything I've said so far, there is a lot of overlap between sulfate-full and sulfate-free shampoos. The pH of the shampoo actually made a bigger difference than whether or not it had sulfates. Higher pH, more alkaline shampoos will leach some dyes out faster. But by far the biggest thing that made a difference was just water. Just washing colored hair in water without shampoo leaches out a ton of dye. The differences between different shampoos are tiny compared to washing versus not washing. So my problem was that a lot of sulfate-free shampoos were formulated to be too gentle to clean my scalp and hair properly. I have a pretty oily scalp, and so that meant that I either washed my hair every day or I just suffered with sticky limp hair and an itchy scalp, and sometimes that happened even if I washed daily. Using a shampoo with sulfates let me wash my hair less often, and so I actually ended up with less fading. Sulfates are also quite cheap, which a lot of people paint as a bad thing, that companies are just using cheap ingredients to save money, even though there might be better, more expensive options. And this does happen, but it's never the only reason formulators use a particular ingredient. Number one, you have to make a product that works. The cheapest ingredient is just water. But if a company tried to sell plain water as a product, it would flop really hard. Number two, price doesn't directly match with quality. I'm sure we all have a favorite cheap meal that we'd happily pick over a bunch of more expensive options. And shout out to this video's sponsor, The Ordinary. Most of us have probably tried some super budget-friendly skincare products from The Ordinary that worked better than more expensive ones. And sulfates do actually have some really good properties that make them great in cleansing products. On top of just the price of the raw material, one of the reasons sulfates work out to be cheap is because they're multifunctional. Obviously, they clean really well, but they also foam well. More foam doesn't actually mean a better clean, but psychologically, if there isn't that much foam, most people just don't think it's doing a good job. Sulfates also help create a thicker texture, and you can usually add a bit of salt to make a sulfate product thicken even more. Shampoos need to be a little bit thick so it sits nicely in your hand and you can get it onto your hair effectively. It also makes it feel more concentrated. A lot of other surfactants don't have these properties, so if you take out the sulfates, you often have to add in a bunch of other ingredients to boost the foam and make it thicker, which adds to the cost. Let's take a look at The Ordinary's Sulfate 4% Cleanser for Body and Hair, which is a pretty stripped back shampoo formula. Sodium laureth sulfate is the anionic surfactant. It's at 4%, which you can hopefully tell from the name. This is pretty low for a shampoo, but this also doubles up as a body wash, which normally has lower amounts, so this keeps it gentle. Specifically, they're using SLES2, which means there's two ethoxy units per molecule. This is the most common type used in shampoos because it gives a good balance between cleaning, gentleness, and cost. Apart from the anionic surfactant, we have some other ingredients. Water is the first ingredient, and that's pretty important. It keeps the surfactants spread out the right way when you put them on your hair or skin. If it's too concentrated, it's really harsh. You do not want 100% surfactant on your skin or your hair, trust me. Getting the right dilution also affects the thickness of the shampoo. Polysorbate 20 is another surfactant. It's not as good at cleaning and it's usually used as a solubilizer, so it might be in there to help the tocopherol dissolve. Xanthan gum is a thickener that makes the texture thicker. Tocopherol is vitamin E, which is an antioxidant. There's a mix of preservatives, which stops the bacteria mold from having a fun multiplying festival inside the shampoo. You need a preservative whenever you have a water-based formula. There are chelating agents, which grab onto metal ions. Metal ions can make anionic surfactants work worse, especially when there's hard water. Chelating agents also help preservatives work better. Like I said, this is a relatively simple formula, so in other shampoos you'll have other ingredients too. You might have other surfactants because combining multiple surfactants can make a cleanser more gentle. Some of them can also boost foam or moisturize skin. Shampoos also often have detangling ingredients because when hair is wet, the cuticle sticks up more, so the surface is rougher and it can snag on other hairs more easily. So most shampoos will have some ingredients that very thinly coat the hair to make a smoothing layer. The most common ingredients for these are polyquaterniums. Sometimes you'll also see colorants, fragrances, and pearlizing agents to make the shampoo look and smell nicer. My scalp gets dry and irritated from a lot of shampoos, so I was pretty curious to see how this very simple formula would go for me. This turned out to be really good for my scalp, one of the better tolerated shampoos I've used. Having multiple surfactants is usually good because it reduces irritation, but they've gotten around this by using a low percentage of a gentle type of SLES. There also isn't any fragrance in this. I personally like a bit of fragrance in my hair products, but I know a lot of people want or need to avoid it. It's actually pretty hard to find fragrance-free hair products, so I'm really happy to see this available as an option. Now on to hair conditioners. Hair conditioners have a few more functions than shampoo, and different people use them for different purposes. If you have short hair, you might not actually need hair conditioner. Conditioners can add shine, smooth over damage, and reduce tangling and static. To do this, they leave a very thin coating on hair strands. There is this myth that cheap conditioners will coat hair, but expensive ones don't. This is not true. You need a coating because your hair is dead, and as it grows, it accumulates damage and ends up looking chipped like this. Hair conditioners smooth over this roughness by plugging in the gaps, so hair doesn't snag and cause more of these bits to break off. The main ingredients used in hair conditioners are cationic surfactants. These are a lot like the anionic surfactants we saw in shampoos, except they have a positively charged head. When hair is wet, it gets a negative charge, and the damaged bits of hair usually have a stronger negative charge. Opposite charges attract, and so these positive heads in the cationic surfactants help them stick to the negatively charged hair. The positive charges are also handy because once you have enough attached, the hair becomes slightly positive, which will actually repel extra cationic surfactants. What this means is you end up with a thinner, more even film that feels silky, rather than the sort of film that you might get with a lot of oils like your natural hair oil that's heavy and weighs hair down. The most common type of cationic surfactant that you'll see in conditioners are quaternary ammonium ions, nicknamed quats. You'll see onium in a lot of their names. The Ordinary's conditioner has 2% Behentrimonium Chloride. In conditioners, these cationic surfactants are usually combined with fatty alcohols. The most common fatty alcohol is stearyl alcohol, which is a mix of cetyl and stearyl alcohol. These fatty alcohols make the conditioner thicker, so it's easier to apply on your hair. More importantly, it also combines with these cationic surfactants to make an ordered arrangement called a lamellar structure. This is a bit like a pile of flat tiles that can slide over each other and coat the hair. These main ingredients are also why a lot of people get breakouts on their back with conditioner. Cationic surfactants are quite irritating, and fatty alcohols are pretty good at clogging pores. So if you find you get a lot of back acne, make sure you scrub your back properly after using conditioner. The Ordinary's conditioner is, again, pretty simple. They've only got 7 ingredients. So there's the cationic surfactant and the fatty alcohol, which are the standard ingredients in every hair conditioner that form that thin conditioning film. We also have water, and just like in shampoos, it's there to make sure everything is at the right concentration and thickness for putting on your wet hair. There's also guar gum, which thickens up the formula more. And of course, there's preservatives to control bacteria and mold. With more complex conditioners, you might have extra ingredients, and these change the sorts of coatings left on the hair. Silicones are really common, and there is a huge range of these. Some tend to be heavier, and people get the impression that silicones always weigh hair down, but this is not a blanket rule. Some silicones, like my favorite amodimethicone, are charged, and so just like the cationic surfactant, you only get a thin film, and any excess stuff actually gets repelled. There are other polymers, like polyquaterniums, similar to what's used in shampoos, to detangle and add volume. You might see natural oils like coconut and argan oil. These tend to form thicker films on hair, and this really weighs it down, and so usually they're used at low concentrations in conditioners. You might also have hydrolyzed proteins and amino acids. These can penetrate into the hair a bit and add strength by plugging holes in the hair. I was actually quite surprised by how well this worked on my hair. If you followed my hair bleaching journey, you'll know that I pretty much need specialized silicones like amodimethicone to make my hair not be straw. This conditioner detangled my hair really nicely when I was washing it, and it felt nice for about a day, but by day two, my hair started feeling a bit dry. I think this would have been fantastic for my hair before I bleached it, but now I need those extra damage coating ingredients. So I would recommend trying this if your hair is not quite this level of damaged, if you want a conditioner that doesn't weigh your hair down, or if you want something fragrance-free. Again, there really aren't that many options for fragrance-free hair conditioners, so I'm really happy to see this as an option for people who want it. I hope you enjoyed this deep dive into shampoos and conditioners. Let me know if you're interested in other product breakdowns. Make sure you like and subscribe. Links to The Ordinary's hair products are in the description. More videos about cosmetic science are popping up around me now.